Good morning, everyone. Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. My name's Latoya.
And I'm Sean. We're the pastors here, and we are so glad to be worshiping with you this morning. Welcome to worship with Bel Air United Methodist Church. In a few minutes, you're going to meet Haley DeRome. She's a student at Stephen F. Austin University. She's exploring a call to ministry, and she's going to be serving as our pastoral intern here at Bel Air this summer. I can't wait for you to get to know her. It's Pentecost Sunday. Pentecost is a word that means 50 days, because it's 50 days after Easter. It's also the day that marks the outpouring of God's Holy Spirit into the world in a brand new way. My prayer this morning is that in this time of worship, you will be filled, renewed, refreshed by that same Spirit. A couple of notes about this morning's service. Our contemporary and our traditional musicians have teamed up to lead worship, and I'm so excited about what they have planned. So prepare yourself to sing and to make a joyful noise to the Lord. A little bit later in the service, toward the end of the service, we're going to have a chance to remember our baptism. All you need is a little bit of water in a cup or in a bowl, whatever works, just a little bit of water with you as you worship. If you don't have it with you now, go and get it when you can. And though we've gathered in several different places today, we are bound together as one. One body in one Spirit. So take a moment to say hello to your fellow worshipers in the comments section here on Facebook and on YouTube. And if you're new to Bel Air, or if this is your first time worshiping online, welcome. I'm so glad you've come. Now, as we enter into a time of worship, would you join us in our responsive call to worship? We gather together because God has called us. We wait in expectant awe for God's appearing. We are together, old and young, rich and poor. We have come, believers and skeptics, to worship God. On the first Christian Pentecost, there were surprises, the rush of a violent wind, and tongues of fire.
We tremble before the power of the Holy Spirit. What will happen if we let the Spirit in?
On this Pentecost, we can receive the surprises of God. We can be moved to speak and act in new ways.
With expectant eagerness, we welcome the Spirit. We will risk stepping into God's vision for us.
Welcome to worship. Let us sing.
Jesus, our Savior. I believe in God, our Father. I believe in Christ, the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. And our defender. believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion.
I wonder, how often this week have we pondered the manifold works of God? How have we cared for God's amazing creation? What have we done to encourage life at its fullest and best? The truth is, we don't always live up to God's call. Sometimes because we neglect things that we know we should do. Sometimes because we purposely do things we know we shouldn't do. So, let us confess the things we have done and the things we've left undone that separate us from God and from each other. Would you join me in our prayer of confession? O God, we have sought fame and fortune. We have rushed through our days with unseeing eyes, stopped up ears, and dulled emotions. We are more often enslaved by our fears than freed by your grace. We demand proof of your existence, but ignore the work of your hands. We miss the gifts of your Holy Spirit because we insist on being in charge. Have mercy on us, O God. Forgive us and save us from ourselves. Amen. God promises an outpouring of the Spirit. We will see signs and experience wonders that we have not seen before. When we call out to God, our healing, our salvation will come. Because God approaches us with open hands that are filled with good things. And when we are ready to be taught, God grants new insights and a deep abiding peace. Praise God, for in the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Friends, let's hear this morning's reading from the Psalms.
Hi everyone, I'm Haley Jerome, and I'm so happy to be worshiping with you this morning. I'll be serving as a pastoral intern here at Bel Air UMC this summer, and I'm so looking forward to our time together. Let's listen for God's word from Psalm 104. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord my God, you are very great. You are clothed with honor and majesty, wrapped in light as with a garment. You stretch out the heavens like a tent. You set the beams of your chambers on the waters. You make the clouds your chariot. You ride on the wings of the wind. You make the winds your messengers, fire and flame your ministers. O Lord, how manifold are your works. In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. Yonder is the sea, great and wide. Creeping things innumerable are there, living things both small and great. There go the ships and Leviathan that you form to sport in. These all look to you to give them their food in due season. When you give to them, they gather it up. When you open your hand, they are filled with good things. When you hide your face, they are dismayed. When you take away their breath, they die and return to their dust. When you send forth your spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the ground. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. Who looks on the earth and it trembles, who touches the mountains and they smoke. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have being. May my meditation be pleasing to him, for I rejoice in the Lord.
Thank you, Haley. Just as we heard in the scripture reading, we are reminded to sing our praises to God, but the Bible also reminds us to pray and to cast our cares to him, for he cares for us. So now I would like to invite you to join me in prayer as we do just that, as we bring our petitions, our hopes, our joys, all that we need, we can cast it to God. Let us pray. Gracious God, there is none like you in all the earth. You are a father to the fatherless, a mother to the motherless, a friend to the friendless. You are our rock. Today, as we celebrate the day of Pentecost, we thank you for the fire of salvation that burns so brightly in us. We pray, O Lord, that you will be our igniter, and in that, remind us, dear God, of your great power that is within us to do your work of ministry in your kingdom. We are thankful that you empower and enable us to reach out to others, for our salvation is not simply that we would be saved, but for all to experience your wonder, your love, your grace, and your mercy. Help us where we fall short, where we fail to shine your light, where we forget that the fire and passion within us for the things we desire wouldn't exist without you, and the breath of life that you breathe into us each and every day, we would not have it without you. Forgive us, we pray, for not being faithful to spread your good news. We have found ourselves comfortable, and we often resist when you shake things up. Help us to lean into your will and your way. Help us to lean not to our own understandings, but in all our ways to acknowledge you and the great commission to make disciples of all the world without partiality. By your Holy Spirit, make us one with Christ and one with each other. May our conversations with people of every language and culture around us witness to your grace and mercy. Ignite within those who are weary, a renewed spirit. Bring provision to those who are hungry and thirsty in the midst of lack. Bring healing, O Lord, to those who are not well, whether it be physical, mental, or emotional. We ask for healing for every disease. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Holy Spirit, order our steps in spirit and in truth that we may not grow weary in well-doing, but help us to know that we will reap if we faint not. We need your strength. We need your wisdom, and we thank you for your grace to be in communion with you. Help us to hear your voice, to see your ways, and to receive with joy your truth. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And now, brothers and sisters, I invite you to join me as we pray the Lord's Prayer that Jesus taught his disciples so long ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Church family, let us continue to worship God through our giving. We thank you for all of the ways that you support the ministry of this church through prayer, through time, through talents, and yes, through financial resources. You make a difference when you give. Without you, we couldn't do the work of ministry that we do here at Bel Air UMC. So we thank you. We appreciate you. You are a blessing. Today, as we continue to worship God through the giving of tithes and offering, I encourage you to give freely and joyfully, just as Scripture tells us to do. You can give online at belairumc.org/give. You can also give via text message by texting the word give to the number on the screen. And if you prefer to give by check, you can write that check now and mail it to the address on the screen, the address of the church. Thank you again so much for all that you do to support the ministry of the church. Thank you, thank you. Thank you. Let us pray. Holy God, thank you for sending your Spirit, the Spirit of the risen Christ from heaven. Help us to be like the early disciples, praying patiently as we wait for your guidance and power. Fill our hearts and minds with your gifts of faith, hope, and love. We dedicate ourselves and our offering to your good purpose in the world through our church's mission by the power of your Holy Spirit. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, your presence,
let's pray. Almighty God, as you did on the first Pentecost, send your Spirit to fill the homes where we have gathered this morning. Open our ears, our eyes, our hearts, and our minds, so that we might be refreshed, renewed, enlivened by the word you will speak to us today. And God, may the words of my mouth and the thoughts of all of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing to you, for you are our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Our scripture is from Acts chapter 2. It tells the story of the very first Pentecost, when God's Spirit was unleashed into the world in a brand new way. If you've got your Bible with you, it's the book of Acts, beginning in chapter 2, verse 1. If you've downloaded this morning's digital worship guide, you'll find the text printed there as well. Listen for the word of God. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly, from heaven, there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues, as of fire, appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. 50 days after the resurrection, they were all together in one place. How many of them there were, we don't know. It's at least the 12 disciples, probably also the women who had been with Jesus since the beginning, maybe many, many more. They were all together in one place. Did you notice what that place was? When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven, there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. On the first Pentecost, the disciples weren't at the temple. They hadn't come to church. They were at home. And not a single one of them was beyond God's reach. Divided tongues like fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. They were at home, just like you are this morning, and not a single one of you is beyond God's reach. The first Pentecost is very clear evidence that God is happy to break into our homes and fill them with his presence. The very first Pentecost is clear evidence that God has already taken what we think of as an ordinary space, our home, our living room, and transformed it into a holy place. I wonder if you've noticed that these weeks that you've been worshiping at home, that God can take an ordinary space and make it a holy place. That there's not some huge gulf between the sacred and the secular, but that the God you thought you had to go looking for has been with you all along. The story of Pentecost reminds us year after year that the Holy Spirit swoops in and out among us, that not a single one of us is beyond God's reach. And you know, on big Sundays like this, on Pentecost and Easter and other big days in the church year, when I'm preparing sermons, I go back and look at my notes from previous years. What did I say last year? Mostly, it's so that I don't say the same thing over and over and over again, but it's also to make sure that I remember what's important. So I went back and I looked at my notes from last year. And I want to tell you the exact same thing I told you last year on Pentecost, because it's important. Last year, this is what I said. I said, the story of Pentecost is told each year, a message from the church for the church, passed down through the millennia to remind us that no matter what life is like today, no matter what the church is like today, we still believe in a God who blows through closed doors and sets our heads on fire. We still believe in a God with the power to transform us, both as individuals and as a community. We still believe that Christ, who was dead, is alive again, because we still believe in a God who blows new life into old, dead places. The world has changed. The church has changed. God's work through the Spirit has not. That's what I told you, word for word, last year. And it's still the thing that matters today. The world has changed. The church has changed. God's work through the Spirit has not changed. The world has changed. It's maybe the most obvious thing I could say today. The way we live and move and act in the world has changed in the past 3 months. And at first, we all talked about, you know, when things go back to normal, but we're discovering more and more that there's no going back to the way things used to be. Whenever an individual or a family or a community experiences trauma, there's no going back to before the trauma, because life has changed, and life has changed us. The only thing to do now is to begin living into a new normal. The church has changed. Again, that feels like a very obvious thing to say as I preach to a camera and you worship at home. It's kind of interesting, though, to think about our church in particular. Last Pentecost, Pentecost 2019, we were all together here in this sanctuary. We had one big worship service because it was the last Sunday before renovations began. We were getting ready to move out of the sanctuary and into the gym to worship there for a season. And this Pentecost, we've been pushed even further out of the sanctuary, but not to one other place, but to 100 different places scattered all over the city. And wouldn't you know, not a single one of our homes was beyond God's reach. God has taken all these ordinary spaces and made them holy places. The world has changed. The church has changed. God's work through the Spirit has not changed. There are a lot of people in the world who say that they've never had an experience of the Holy Spirit. And maybe because they think it's supposed to look or sound or feel a certain way. But these same people who said they've never met the Spirit, when they begin to talk about their lives, it's very clear that they have. They just didn't know what to call it. So they called it coincidence or intuition or conscience or goosebumps or some other such thing. And maybe that's all it was for them. But just in case you've had something happen to you that you didn't quite know what to call it, I want to suggest a few ways that I think you can tell when the Holy Spirit is at work. When you have tears come to your eyes that you didn't expect, it's probably the Spirit. When a sight or a sound or a smell takes you back to a wonderful memory, that's probably the Spirit. When you struggle and struggle and struggle with a problem and then finally it clicks, what you need to do, that's probably the Spirit. When you see a relationship heal, when you hear the words, I'm sorry, when you sense a new beginning, when you find friendship in an unexpected place, when you see joy or peace or patience or kindness, that's the Spirit. God's work through the Spirit is an ongoing gift in our lives. Now, it's sometimes a bit hard to pin down. There's a certain mystery to how the Spirit works and where the Spirit shows up. Even Jesus says, the Spirit's like the wind. It blows where it pleases. You hear its sound, but you can't tell where it comes from or where it's going. And yet, in the midst of that mystery, in the midst of a changing church in a changing world, the work of the Spirit goes on. And the question that the people who gathered on that first Pentecost asked is still the right question for us to ask today. Those first people gathered on Pentecost were amazed and perplexed, and they said to one another, what does this mean? What does it mean? What does it mean in a changing church, in a changing world, that God's work through the Spirit has not changed? There are two things that are true in the text that are true for us today. First, the Spirit gives us ability that we didn't otherwise have. On the first Pentecost, all these farm boy, fishermen, Galilean disciples start speaking foreign languages. And they do it with such skill and ability that native speakers of those languages thought that they'd found a friend from home. And the disciples didn't have those languages buried deep somewhere inside their brains. It wasn't some untapped natural ability. No, the Spirit gave it to them. The Spirit gave them an ability that they didn't otherwise have. You see, the Spirit doesn't just help you find the courage that's already deep inside. The Spirit gives you courage that you didn't have before. The Spirit doesn't help you find strength you didn't know you have. No, the Spirit gives you strength that you didn't have. This is why we can accomplish abundantly far more by allowing God to work through us than by working harder and trying to do it all by ourselves. The Spirit gives us ability that we didn't otherwise have. And this is the second thing. The Holy Spirit pushes us out. That's what happens to the disciples on the first Pentecost. They are pushed out. They were in the house together, but the house fills up with the Holy Spirit and pushed them out to the streets where they speak in tongues, because not a single Jew in Jerusalem was beyond God's reach. And as the story goes on, the Spirit pushes them even further afield to all Judea and Samaria, and then to all the ends of the earth, because not a single person, not a single place in all the world is beyond God's reach. And I want to close this morning with a symbolic act, one that I want you to do at home too. It's a very simple remembering of our baptism. All you need is a little bit of water. If you don't have it with you now, go get it. Just in a cup or in a bowl. It doesn't have to be fancy. You don't have to get out the good china. You can, but God can take any ordinary thing and make it a holy thing. And we are remembering our baptism on Pentecost because the thing we say to every person we baptize is this: may the Holy Spirit work within you. So take what water you have, and whether you're by yourself or with others, doesn't matter. Everyone take the water and dip your fingers in, and then with those same fingers, make the sign of the cross on your forehead. Do it now. And if you've got little kids with you, you can do it for them. Make the sign of the cross on your forehead. Feel the cool water against your skin. Remember your baptism and be glad. And hear this: the Holy Spirit will work within you. The Holy Spirit will work within you to give you ability that you didn't otherwise have. And it will be just what you need: strength, courage, faith, hope, love, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, joy. The Spirit will work within you, because not one single person, not one single place is beyond God's reach. Let's pray. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Fill our homes with your power. Kindle flaming hearts within us. Give us what we need to be your faithful people. And then push us out of our comfort zones, out of our quarantine funks, and out of our selfish desires, into abundant life with you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Before we sing, I want to make sure you know about a couple of things. Next Sunday, we'll be online only again for worship, so I'll see you here at 9 a.m. or 11:05 a.m. We'll be starting a new series on the Book of Daniel. Also, make sure you go to belairumc.org/stayconnected. You'll find this week's Bible reading plan, a place to send in your prayer requests, and updates on all that's happening here at Bel Air UMC and how you can stay connected to God, to others, and to service in the week ahead. Friends, thank you for worshiping here this morning. Would you join once again as we sing?
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope and without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from the throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise forever to the
saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus for our sake you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one, God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings.
In the morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till the stones moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored.
And the Church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not
friends, go in peace to serve God and your neighbor in all that you do. And may the peace of Christ go with you. Amen.